helping you go through your whole entire book. Please don't forget to like, subscribe, so that more people will be able to see this content. Let's talk about administrative discipline. So administrative discipline for your exam, again, remember, the reason why you're going through the pre-licensing or post-licensing requirements is to protect the public. This is what you need to remember for the exam. It's a misdemeanor and or imprisonment for a year and a $1,000 fine. So now let's talk about revocation and suspensions. Revocation and suspension, right? Earlier we talked about administrative discipline. For whatever reason, you're found that you're breaking real estate law for doing something unethical. It's up to the DOS, the Department of State, to determine what type of fine you're gonna receive. Now, of course, they're gonna give you the opportunity to appeal, but revocation is them taking away your license or altogether or suspension. Of course, it's gonna depend on exactly what you're being accused of. So revocation, they're taking back the license because you did something that you know that you're not supposed to do. That's the reason why we have 75 hours of licensing, is to basically give you all the information to let you know what you're allowed to do, what you should not do, or suspension. Maybe suspension while an investigation is going on. But that determination is gonna be by the Department of State. And again, you will have an opportunity to appeal and speak before the board. So now let's talk about unlicensed assistants. You as a brand new agent, you probably won't have an unlicensed assistant, so you don't have to worry about this. But for exam purposes, an unlicensed assistant, anything that's dealing with negotiating has to be a licensed agent. Now, the unlicensed assistant can help with advertising, they can schedule appointments, they can assist as far as handing out flyers, you can have them at an open house. But when it comes to discussing price or trying to negotiate price, they have to be licensed. So just remember that for the exam. Unlicensed assistants, another thing too, is that you probably want them to be on a salary or hourly, not with them being paid per transaction. So if you see an exam question that talks about unlicensed assistants being paid a commission off a transaction, just know that that's incorrect. You have to be licensed in order to be paid by a transaction. So they want an unlicensed assistant to be either on an hourly or salary basis. So property disclosure, which we call a PCD for the exam, you need to know that if the buyer, now we're not talking about all buyers. So let's say I'm holding an open house and I have several potential buyers that's coming through, but none of them have placed an offer. I'm not required to give them a PCD, a property condition disclosure, right? The only time that I'm required to do this is when we're actually about to go into the transaction. I'm not working with any other buyers. That buyer has submitted an offer. That offer has turned into a contract. Now I will submit the property condition disclosure, the PCD. If my client, the seller, does not supply that to the buyer, then my client, the seller, will receive a $500 fine if they do not present the PCD to the buyer. Now remember, only the buyer that's in the transaction. So if someone is just going to an open house and they're just looking around, they don't get a copy of the PCD. Remember that for the exam. A PCD, property condition disclosure, is the seller's opportunity to reveal everything there is about a property. Because later on, when we talk about statutes of limitation, in New York State, you have 6 years on a written real estate transaction to sue. The buyer will have 6 years to sue. So the reason why the PCD is so important, it gives the seller an opportunity to discuss everything about the property. Now, if you're working with the seller and they're not too sure, or maybe they bought the property but never lived in the property, well then I would just have them spend the $500 so that the buyer can now use those funds towards getting a third party, an inspector, to inspect the property. You can tell your client to do that as well. You can talk to the seller and say, okay, well, if you don't know anything about the property, how about just pay for an inspector to come? That way, if you ever end up in court, fine can tell the judge that they were not that familiar with the property, so they thought it would be better for them to have a third party to come in. And they paid for. They paid for a third party to come in. So that way, in the court's eyes, it doesn't look like the client was trying to withhold some defects or some facts about the property. The next one is stigmatized property disclosure. So a stigmatized property disclosure is a property that had either a homicide, suicide, someone died of AIDS there. I guess today would be somebody that passed away of COVID, maybe at home, maybe they didn't make it to the hospital, right? Because now we're in a COVID-19 generation. So I'm quite sure that will be added soon. Shout out to those families that's going through COVID-19 that have lost family members and friends. My heart is with you guys. This is definitely a tough time for you guys. So a stigmatized property disclosure is going to be something that stigmatizes a property. So a lot of people don't know that legally, the seller does not have to disclose that information. So if there was a suicide, a homicide, something horrific that happened at the property, a buyer may use that as an opportunity to get a lower price on the property because they would say, hey, everybody know that this incident happened at your property. Can you drop the price? So New York State law protects the seller. They do not have to disclose it. Even if the buyer requested or the buyer's agent requested. Let's say I'm representing the seller. I'm the listing agent / seller's agent. I'm working for the seller. And you submit a request to me, whether it's verbally or in writing. I don't have to answer, right? And I'm covered legally by the seller. The only way that I'm allowed to reveal that information is if the seller gives me permission. Because remember, by me revealing that information, the seller is going to be offered less money for their house. If the seller finds out that I revealed the information without his or her permission, now they're going to sue me for the difference. So only if the seller gives permission to say that there was a homicide, suicide, somebody died of COVID-19, am I allowed to disclose it. Now, any other scenario, we as licensed salespersons, associate brokers, and brokers, yes, I tell my agents all the time, if it's pertaining to the property, we have to disclose it. Whether our client wants us to discuss it or not, right? We have to disclose it because only you can protect your license. But in a situation of a stigmatized property, and this is the reason why it's one of the terms that you're going to be tested on, we as real estate professionals are not allowed to disclose information about a property that has nothing to do with water leaks or some type of defect, some type of structural, something pertaining to the property itself. Because remember, homicide, suicide, COVID-19, someone dying of AIDS, doesn't mean that the property now physically is not, you know, where it's supposed to be. It's not sound. Because trust me when I say this, investors will still purchase the property. So if it's not already in the news, you're working with the buyer and you're looking to get this information, just Google the address, see if anything comes up. But if it's not something that was reported or made the news, then more than likely, you're probably not going to know. You're just not going to know. So that's stigmatized property. Please don't forget to like, subscribe, so that more people will be able to see this content.